guys can get you a bit of a...
Good morning and welcome to our Lord's Day service. As we begin, I invite all of us into a time of silent prayer to prepare our hearts as we are remembering the grace and the mercy that the Lord has shown to us to gather us. And just want to remind you as we look here at the candles as well, another one is lit for the third week of Advent, this third week of the waiting season in which we are remembering and waiting that day to celebrate Christ who has come, that God has taken on flesh and dwelt among us, that we have seen his glory, the light of the world come. And yet, here and now, we are reminded we still wait and we still groan with all of creation for God to come make all things new, that Christ will make all things new. So as we are reminded of his grace and mercy that draws us near to him, that calls each and every one of us by name, let's take some time now to pray, prepare our hearts, that we would so seek to be humbled by his majesty and his splendor, his holiness, and that we would come and see the King who comes and meets us here. So let's take some time to pray now. With one heart, with one voice, and as one church, let us sing praise to the Lord, the Almighty.
Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise him, for he is thy health and salvation. All ye who hear, now to his temple draw near. Join me in glad adoration. Praise to the Lord who o'er all things so wondrously reigneth. Shelters thee under his wings, he so gently sustaineth. Hast thou not seen how thy desire there have been granted in what he ordained?
Let's all stand.
Praise to the Lord, oh let all that is in me adore him. All that hath life and breath come now with praises before him. Let the amen sound from his people again. before I we adore Him.
Let me on it.
Let the Amen sound from His people again. Rally for I we adore Him.
And please hear the call to worship this morning, which comes from Psalm 85, verses 7 to 13. Show us your steadfast love, O Lord, and grant us your salvation. Let me hear what God the Lord will speak, for He will speak peace to His people, to His saints, but let them not turn back to folly. Surely His salvation is near to those who fear Him, that glory may dwell in our land. Steadfast love and faithfulness meet. Righteousness and peace kiss each other. Faithfulness springs up from the ground, and righteousness looks down from the sky. Yes, the Lord will give what is good, and our land will yield its increase. Righteousness will go before Him and make His footsteps a way. Amen.
Let us pray. Our most gracious and heavenly Father, Father of lights, Father to the orphan, Father to the fatherless, Lord, we come now in Jesus' name, your one and only begotten Son, who, full of grace and truth, dwelt among His people in a world full of darkness and misery. We thank you for this time of this Advent season when we come to reflect on the coming of Jesus Christ, the true light of the world. And Lord, we thank you that you have so gathered us to behold this wondrous light. And Lord, we see that though we are full of shame and our dark works have been exposed by the light of Christ, Lord, you do not condemn us. But God, that you have shown your mercy to us by forgiving us of our sins, by cleansing us of our filth, by making us pure like Christ. And so now that we would be children of light, and so Lord, we thank you that you would so shine your light that we would become light. And so now, Lord, we come now to consider your great salvation in Christ Jesus. How you have spoken to us from your word of this grace that has come to us. This mercy that has come to us in the person of Christ. And even how the justice of God has been met at the cross of Christ. And how the life of Christ is now in us by faith. And so, Lord, we thank you. Lord, we give our honor and glory to you. And we are especially mindful, O Lord, of how your work of bringing salvation to this world, that it continues forth through your church. And we see how you are shining the light, your light, through the church. And we see that the world full of darkness is trying to combat it. How we consider the early reign covenant church in China. How indeed this church, our Chinese brothers and sisters are being persecuted for their faith, and how the darkness continues to battle. But Lord, we know that the light will overcome the darkness. And so Lord, we ask that your light would shine ever brighter through their affliction and trial and tribulation. And we ask that they would value the honor of being the light of Christ to this world, even if at great cost to themselves. And so, Lord, we pray for your grace and strength to be upon them. And Lord, we pray for your church here at OKPCA, that we would be a light to this community, a light to Orlando, a light to the many people in this city. That though the city, with all of its sunshine, Lord, we know that it is full of darkness. And that the only true light is the light of Christ. And so, Lord, would you use us? May we be a standing witness to this community as we have gathered here on this Lord's Day to proclaim Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And so now may your Spirit be poured onto us, that we behold your glory and that we would faithfully reflect that glory to the light to this world that is in need of Jesus Christ. And so, Lord, now would you lead us by your Spirit to worship you in this place, to proclaim the glories of our God, of our Almighty Lord. And so, Lord, we thank you so much. Lord, we pray for Pastor John as he presides over this service. Would you use him in a mighty way, and that we would be reminded of our hope and of our faith in Christ. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us now sing songs of praise to our God.
Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of the Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. As you find me, all my fears and failures, come fill my life again. Forgive my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. Now I surrender.
Oh, The yoke of sin has been broken. Once a slave, now by grace, no more condemnation. Unto us a son is given, unto us a child is born. He who is mighty has done a great thing, taken on flesh, conquered death's sting, shattered the darkness and lifted our shame. Holy is His name. Holy is His name. Now my soul magnifies the Lord. I rejoice in the God who saves. I will trust His unfailing love. I will sing His praise.
His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty, from where he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. You may have your seats. We will now continue in our worship in giving the top and our tithes and offerings.
Please pray with me for the offering. Holy Father, we thank you that you are our gracious provider, that Lord, in Christ we have all things, that you know our every need, and that Lord, that you supply just what we need every time, that Lord, that we can look to you and know that we will never fall short of what we need in you. So Lord, we thank you for this time to have this offering here, where we pray that you would use this offering for your kingdom, for your glory, that your gospel would continue to go forth to all the nations, and that, Lord, that you would continue to draw people near by the glorious wonders of the good news of Jesus Christ. So, Lord, as we look to you, Lord, we pray that you would so once again encourage us and challenge us to look to you and trust in your provision and all that you have given us in Christ. So Lord, we thank you once again. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, let's all stand and greet one another in the name of Christ. At this time, I invite you guys to turn in your bulletins. We'll be looking at a few of the announcements that will be happening in our church for the next few weeks. And so, once again, we welcome all of you here in the name of Christ. It's a wonderful, as we look at announcement number two, today marks our third week of Advent, which is the season of waiting. And so we are reminded of next week that we get to celebrate the incarnation of Christ, that God has taken on flesh, that Christ has come for our salvation, for our to pay the price for our sins, that we may have life in Him. And so during this Advent season, we do ask and may we all give thanks to God for sending His only Son, Christ Jesus. But may we also be mindful that the Advent season is not just looking back at Christ's coming, but it's also looking forward for us. That this is a season of waiting even now. We wait for Christ to return. We wait for Christ to come and make all things new. And so, as the Apostle Paul says in the letter to the Romans, that we groan with all of creation until that day. And so may we be mindful this month that we are awaiting for Christ to come again, and that with the Apostle John at the end of the book of Revelation, that we can say, "Come, Lord Jesus, come." And so may this be a great season of looking back and reflecting on God's good grace to us in Christ, as well as looking forward to the hope that we have in Christ as well. Number three, the 2018 Christmas Special Performance event will be on Christmas Sunday, which is next week, December 23rd at 1:30 p.m. And I just want to clarify as well, we will be having all of our regular services. So our 8 o'clock service, our 11 o'clock service, those will be our worship services. And then our 1:30 service will be a special just performance service. And so just to clarify that 1:30 is not our worship services. So please make sure you guys are here either at our 8 o'clock or 11 o'clock service for that. And then stick around after lunch for our 1:30 special performance event. Number four, listed here are the new Mission Committee officers for 2019. So please take a look at that for all the officers there. Number five, the organized 2019 MIC and WIC new officer candidates are listed there as well. So please take time to look at all the names there. Number six, MIC or Men in Church and WIC Women in Church. They'll have their annual meeting today, December 16th, and this will be at 1:30 p.m. Number seven, there will be a 2019 Budget Committee meeting, and this will be right after the MIC annual meeting today. December 16th, and this will be in the library. Number eight, the 2019 Deacon Seminar meeting will be today, December 16th, starting at 4 p.m. For the 2019 OKPCA ministry. And so for our English ministry, our deacons meeting will not be 4 p.m., but it will be at 3 p.m. And so please keep that in mind, that 3 p.m. we'll be having our deacons meeting for our English ministry. Number nine, our church session has approved Pastor Tae Yong Lee to start his ministry as the KM assistant pastor starting from today, December 16th. And so if you see him and his wife during lunch, please feel free to say hello and greet them and you know tell them who you are and how excited we are to have them here and serve here. So Pastor Tae Yong Lee will be the new Korean ministry assistant pastor. Number 10, the New Year's Eve service will be on Monday, December 31st. The service will start at 10 p.m., but if you want to partake in all of the New Year's Eve festivities, those will begin at 8 p.m. And so we'll be having a rice cake soup dinner, as well as a Korean traditional game, highly competitive. And so please make time to come with your families to the 8 o'clock if you're able to, but just keep in mind the service does start at 10 p.m. on that Monday. Number 11, the 2019 New Year special revival meeting will be from January 4th to January 6th, and the main theme will be miracles. And so listed there are the meeting times for there for the revival meeting there. Number 12, YFC or Youth for Christ, you guys will continue to meet this Friday starting at 6:30 p.m. and starting with dinner. Number 13, the EM Adults Pentateuch Bible Study class will continue to meet as well at 7:15 p.m. on Wednesday. Number 14, you guys will have seen this in your bulletins. There is a flyer in there, and this is in regards to the youth group winter outing. There's some information on here that you guys should be well aware of. It's not just enough to sign up or tell Pastor Daniel, but next week, December 23rd, there will be a general admission fee, and I believe that's to go to Pastor Daniel as well. So if you have any questions about that, please ask Pastor Daniel, as well as after service today, please go tell your parents who will probably be paying your admission fee. And so keep that in mind that it's on there. And if you have not already done so, please let Pastor Daniel know or sign up on the registration sheet in the fellowship hall if you have not already done so for this event. Number 15, our EM Young Adults. We will also be having a winter outing, and this will be on December 30th. And so if you have not let me know already, please let me know if you're interested as we're still figuring out the logistics of all of those things, depending on how many people there are. Number 16, shortly after lunch today, our English ministry will have a brief practice for our Christmas performance. I believe everybody should have gotten a text from me earlier this week. The song that we'll be singing is He Who Is Mighty, the one that we just sang. And so we'll be having a brief practice right after lunch, after all that, for practicing for a Christmas performance for next week. As well as youth group, you guys will have a quick run-through for your Christmas performance today with Pastor Daniel in the main sanctuary starting at 12:45 p.m. So please make sure that you guys are timely, because many people are wanting to use the main sanctuary to practice, get things set up. And so in order to save time and be the most efficient, please make sure you guys are there even before 12:45, ready to go at 12:45, main sanctuary. So if you have any questions on any of the announcements, please ask me after service, and I will try to best answer any questions you may have to the best of my ability. But with that, let's now turn to Scripture. We'll continue in our Nehemiah sermon series, and so I invite you guys to turn to Nehemiah chapter 9, and we'll be looking at verses 1 to verse 31, and we'll be reading all 31 verses this morning. So I'll read God's word. I'll pray that the Spirit would open our hearts, that we may not only hear his word, but also respond and be doers of his word, and then we'll dive right in. This is God's word from Nehemiah chapter 9, verses 1 to 31. Now on the 24th day of this month, the people of Israel were assembled with fasting and in sackcloth, and with earth on their heads. And the Israelites separated themselves from all foreigners and stood and confessed their sins and the iniquities of their fathers. And they stood up in their place and read from the book of the law of the Lord their God for a quarter of the day. For another quarter of it, they made confession and worshiped the Lord their God. On the stairs of the Levites stood Jeshua, Bani, Kadmiel, Shebaniah, Bani, Sherebiah, Bani, and Shenani. And they cried with a loud voice to the Lord their God. Then the Levites, Jeshua, Kadmiel, Bani, Hashabniah, Sherebiah, Hodiah, Shebaniah, and Pethiah said, "Stand up and bless the Lord your God from everlasting to everlasting. Blessed be your glorious name, which is exalted above all blessing and praise. You are the Lord, you alone. You have made heaven, the heaven of heavens, with all their host, the earth and all that is on it, the seas and all that is in them, and you preserve all of them, and the host of heaven worships you. You are the Lord, the God who chose Abram and brought him out of Ur of the Chaldeans and gave him the name Abraham. You found his heart faithful before you and made with him the covenant to give to his offspring the land of the Canaanite, the Hittite, the Amorite, the Perizzite, the Jebusite, and the Girgashite. And you have kept your promise, for you are righteous. And you saw the affliction of our fathers in Egypt and heard their cry at the Red Sea and performed signs and wonders against Pharaoh and all his servants and all the people of his land. For you knew that they acted arrogantly against our fathers. And you made a name for yourself as it is to this day. And you divided the sea before them so that they went through the midst of the sea on dry land. And you cast their pursuers into the depths as a stone into mighty waters. By a pillar of cloud you led them in the day, and by a pillar of fire in the night to light for them the way in which they should go. You came down on Mount Sinai and spoke with them from heaven and gave them right rules and true laws, good statutes and commandments, and you made known to them your holy Sabbath and commanded them commandments and statutes and a law by Moses your servant. You gave them bread from heaven for their hunger and brought water for them out of the rock for their thirst. And you told them to go in to possess the land that you had sworn to give them. But they and our fathers acted presumptuously and stiffened their neck and did not obey your commandments. They refused to obey and were not mindful of the wonders that you performed among them. But they stiffened their neck and appointed a leader to return to their slavery in Egypt. But you are a God ready to forgive, gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and did not forsake them. Even when they had made for themselves a golden calf and said, "This is your God who brought you up out of Egypt," and had committed great blasphemies, you in your great mercies did not forsake them in the wilderness. The pillar of cloud to lead them in the way did not depart from them by day, nor the pillar of fire by night to light for them the way by which they should go. You gave your good spirit to instruct them and did not withhold your manna from their mouth. And gave them water for their thirst. 40 years you sustained them in the wilderness, and they lacked nothing. Their clothes did not wear out, and their feet did not swell. And you gave them kingdoms and peoples and allotted to them every corner. So they took possession of the land of Sihon, king of Heshbon, and the land of Og, king of Bashan. You multiplied their children as the stars of heaven, and you brought them into the land that you had told their fathers to enter and possess. So the descendants went in and possessed the land, and you subdued before them the inhabitants of the land, the Canaanites, and gave them into their hand with their kings and the peoples of the land, that they might do with them as they would. And they captured fortified cities and a rich land and took possession of houses full of all good things, cisterns already hewn, vineyards, olive orchards, and fruit trees in abundance. So they ate and they were filled and became fat and delighted themselves in your great goodness. Nevertheless, they were disobedient and rebelled against you and cast your law behind their back and killed your prophets who had warned them in order to turn them back to you. They committed great blasphemies. Therefore, you gave them into the hand of their enemies who made them suffer. And in the time of their suffering, they cried out to you, and you heard them from heaven. And according to your great mercies, you gave them saviors who saved them from the hand of their enemies. But after they had rest, they did evil again before you. And you abandoned them to the hand of their enemies so that they had dominion over them. Yet when they turned and cried to you, you heard from heaven, and many times you delivered them according to your mercies. And you warned them in order to turn them back to your law, yet they acted presumptuously and did not obey your commandments, but sinned against your rules, which if a person does them, he shall live by them. And they turned a stubborn shoulder and stiffened their neck and would not obey. Many years you bore with them and warned them by your spirit through your prophets, yet they would not give ear. Therefore you gave them into the hand of the peoples of the lands. Nevertheless, in your great mercies, you did not make an end of them or forsake them, for you are a gracious and merciful God. This is God's word. Let us pray. Holy Father, we thank you that you are the God who so speaks to us through your very word. That, Lord, we are reminded that you are the God over all history. That, Lord, that we see your redemptive purpose, your redemptive plan through all history. And so, Lord, as we come before your word this morning, Lord, we pray, would you humble our hearts, that your word would be written on our hearts, and that by your spirit, by your grace, will we bear the fruit of transformation as we turn to you. So, Lord, may Christ be seen in the scriptures this day. May Christ be applied to our hearts. And, Lord, may you be adored and worshipped and glorified in our lives. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. This morning, I want to start with just reflecting on just where I was even before Florida. I used to live in Chicago. And if you've ever been to Chicago or up north in the Midwest, the winters are so bad. The winters are frigid, they're cold, it's dark, we lose the sun for a few months. It's filled with a sense of barrenness at times, and even a sense of death that looms over. The trees and the leaves are gone, the plants have all deceased, and we wait anew for spring to come. And in these long winters when I was in Chicago, 24-hour days did not feel like 24 hours. They felt like months and years. And you know, on the initial snowfall of the winter, it looks all great and pretty, winter wonderland. But after the week passes, as the cold gets colder, as it seems darker and darker, as it continues to loom over, there is a sense of feeling a barrenness in the winter. I know for a lot of us in Florida, we don't have this physical winter. Maybe some of us have never experienced such a frigid and cold and even barren winter. But I do think the reason why I bring this image up for us is that we all know and experience times that feel very wintry. We experience times of extreme darkness, extreme times of a loss of hope at times, even experience times that feel often cold and lifeless in the air. Our despair takes over. And so when we see even in movies or pictures, though we may never have experienced physically a winter, we know the feeling of that winter. This is what I will refer to this morning as the wintry soul. A sense of this barrenness, of this despair, of extreme darkness, and even a loss of hope. You know, with this image in mind of even our past experience that we come before, we come here and we see God's people. We've been looking for the past few weeks the wonders of God's word. That God is meeting his people through his very word. And we see the people are responding as God is cutting them to the core, as they're seeing the very character who their God is, and as they see who they are themselves. And this morning, as we come to Nehemiah chapter 9, the reality that we see here is that as God's people come before God's word, they're coming face to face with the very wintry soul. The very despair of their life, the very sinfulness, and even their unfaithfulness to God's ways. They see the very depth of their own darkness. God's word is once again functioning as this mirror before them. And we see this even acknowledged greater as we see the great contrast of God's faithfulness and his mercy and his grace. And how his people respond with a stubbornness, a stiff-neckedness, a disobedience, a faithlessness, a thanklessness, and the list can go on, a doubt, a distrust. You know, in our lives, I think we are far too apathetic to God's word. Right? God's word to us is a revealing word. It reveals who God is to us, but it also reveals to us the very truth, the very reality of the very wintry soul in which we live in. The very depths of the darkness, the very depths of our sinfulness, the very depths of ourselves that are unfaithful to such a faithful God. And the way that we know this is oftentimes when we read God's word. Even when we might come on a Lord's Day, we love to just pick and choose just the encouraging things for us. But the things that are to target our very hearts and to even rebuke us in his grace, to teach us, to mold us, to change us, to turn to him, to lose a self-confidence in ourselves and have more self-esteem and to have more of an esteem in Christ, not a self-esteem in ourselves. What we see here is in the very despair, in the very darkness of our sin, of our unfaithfulness, as we see before a mirror in ourselves, we actually get a sweeter taste of God's grace. And this is where we get the phrase today for today's sermon title, grace that grows sweeter in the winter. This is not specifically talking about the winter season itself, but the very fact of experiencing the wintry soul. All right, this is a phrase that comes from a Puritan pastor and writer, Samuel Rutherford. I expanded a little bit. The actual phrase is grace that grows, or grace grows in the winter. But what we see here is in the darkest despair of God's people, in our own lives, of even the hopelessness and the darkness of our sin, that we cannot settle ourselves, we find God's grace even sweeter. And throughout Nehemiah chapter 9, we see a God who freely gives his grace and mercy. And in receiving that grace and mercy, it's a call for us to bless and to praise him. So this morning we'll be looking at three brief points. That we must thank him, we must thank God. Main point number two is going to be that we must be cut to the core. We must be broken by his word. And lastly, we must turn to his mercy and grace alone. Right away in verse 1, we see a couple days have passed, right? In Nehemiah chapter 8, we've seen the first day of the festival, second day, they come before the word. Now it's the 24th day in the month. It's about a couple days since the festival days have passed. If you remember the festival days, they've happened every year, and the people are to come and to rejoice in the Lord and his provision and his shelter, the fact that God is the God over his people. And it was a time of great rejoicing for his people every year, the same time around. But now we get to this point where the festival days are over. And in a way, it's quite strange what we see here. It's a reversal of what we might think. We would think that it would be first a time of sorrow. Remember, the people were weeping in chapter 8, and Nehemiah says, don't weep, rejoice. So it starts with rejoicing for them. And now in chapter 9, we come to a place of great sorrow, of looking at great darkness and despair in their very sin and unfaithfulness. It's quite strange, this reversal in a way. But altogether, I think what we're to see here is that foundational to all of this is the joy of the Lord. Even when the people are being cut to the core, when they're being broken beyond measure, when they're being sunken down, when their self-confidence is broken in themselves, when their sin is before their eyes, how they've walked unfaithfully to the Lord and in his ways. You know, what we see here also is that we must not dismiss the reality of life. We must not dismiss our past. You see, this is not just a cover-up of sorts, right? God's people were in exile. God has brought them out, and the people are being reminded, even here and now, why they were sent into exile, why God has left them to be conquered by their enemies. And the reason was is because of their very own hearts of idolatry, their very waywardness to not seek the Lord, to walk in all his ways. And they're reminded of their past walk. And we see that the joy of the Lord is not to push all of that under the rug or under the carpet for them, but they must truly reflect. And it's a time now for them to reflect. And what we see here is that this provides for them a more substantial, a more durable joy. It's not just a joy that meets us in the good times alone. Right? This is often what we chase after, isn't it, in our lives? A temporary joy. We don't want to look at our weaknesses. We don't want to look at our failures. We don't want to look at the depth of how we have not served the Lord faithfully in our lives, how we have failed in loving him and then loving others. And what we see here is that there's a time and place for this. Not so that we'll be sunken in despair alone, but that from there that we may see the grace that is sweeter, the mercy that is more. We see here the people as they hear the preaching of God's word once more. This is another long sermon, right? It's about 3 hours of hearing the law read. But then the 3 hours leads to another 3 hours of confession and worship. This is how deeply they are cut to the core. They must respond to God's word. And we see this, right? From verse 5 and onwards. That they're called to bless the Lord, called to praise the Lord, right? We are reminded that they're to stand up and bless the Lord your God from everlasting to everlasting. Blessed be your glorious name, which is exalted above all blessing and praise. It's amazing here is that as this leads the people into a great time of prayer, of confession before the Lord, that this confession we have to be mindful of is pleasing worship to the Lord. Right, we often think that what pleases the Lord in worship is when we externally look happy, when everything in our life is going well, when we just do the right things, when we say the right things. But what is pleasing to the Lord, a worship that is pleasing, is a broken heart. A contrite heart that comes before the Lord. The people are coming and confessing, and in a way this is also praising the Lord. And we see how their prayer starts in verse 6. It starts not just saying that God is my God, God is the God over us. It starts with God is the God of the universe, right? We read this, you are the Lord, you alone, you have made heaven, the heaven of heavens, with all their hosts, the earth and all that is on it, the seas and all that is in them, and you preserve all of them. And the host of heaven worships you. This is not just some tribal God. This is not just the God of Israel. This is the God of the universe, the one who has made everything, the one who has ordered all things, and the one who has made every person, every mountain, every ocean, every star that is hung. And they are attributing God all the glory here. This is the backdrop of their confession. You are the God over all things. And we're reminded, as you know, what the Apostle Paul says in Romans 1, in verse 19 and 23, that all, even nature itself attests to the glory of God. It attests to this glorious Creator, the one who's created all things. And yet, the one who's deserving all the glory, we plagiarize his work. We all know what plagiarizing is, right? We take credit for what we have not done. We take credit for someone else's work. How often in our own pride and our selfishness, we plagiarize God's glory. And this is not what's happening here amongst God's people. As they're truly confessing, they're saying, this God is the one who's deserving of all glory, all of life, everything in history, all of the world is for his glory, for his name. And yet they are also reminded here in verse 7 that this God who has created all things is also the God who so deeply knows them. They now refer to the Lord, the God who chose Abraham, the forefather of their faith, of our faith. Out of all the things, a multitude of what God has created, the vast array of the universe, that God would look and choose them, would choose us. And not only choose and know, but that he would stoop down low and make a covenant, enter into a relationship, a continual, steadfast relationship with his people. That they and that we may know of his unending joy that he brings. Right? We have to be mindful that God does not have to do this. God does not have to stoop down low. God does not have to condescend. He could have just merely have left us in our very sin. As we're reminded of Adam and Eve who have broken that first covenant relationship. The Bible should have ended at Genesis chapter 3. Upon sin entering, they already knew the curse of death apart from Christ, or apart from the Lord. Yet in this covenant, as they are reminded that this God of the universe is also the God who stoops low to meet them. They're not appealing to themselves. They're not trying to justify themselves. They're not trying to say, this is why God should love us, and this is why God has chosen us. But simply out of his mere mercy and grace, out of his very favor and love for his people, has he done so. Right? And we see this at the end of verse 8 when they say, you have kept your promise. This covenant that you've made, you have kept it because you are righteous. You are perfect. You do all things good and right. They're not saying, you have kept your promise because we are righteous, because we have done right. They're seeing right away here, it's only because of the mercy of God in which they stand, in which this relationship is not completely broken off. A question that we have to ask ourselves, are we a people who are full of thanksgiving, full of praise to the God who has made every star, the whole universe, and all things for himself and for his glory? Are we thankful and full of praise that he is a God who has made us for himself? That in him we find our great joy and our purpose and meaning in life? Or in our own pride, in our own stiff-neckedness, have we loved the life of plagiarism, seeking glory for ourselves, or loving and devoting ourselves to things that are lesser than God himself? We're reminded of that with the Apostle Paul once again in Romans 1 as he reflects and he calls and he tells the people that they have worshipped and loved and devoted their life to the created things and not the Creator. How often we love the blessings we have from the Lord and not love the Lord. How often those things that we've received, how often they don't translate back to us praising and worshiping him. How often we live a life plagiarizing God of his glory. When all thanks, all praise, all blessing is to be to his name alone. You see, the people are cut to the core as they reflect on this. The God of the universe has come down and dwelt and is making a relationship with us. And what is to be called, therefore, in a relationship is that it's a mutual street, right? The people should respond faithfully. They are the subjects of this. They're the ones who are they're benefiting from this. There's nothing God benefits from this. He's the one who condescended. He's the one who stooped low. And yet what we see here from verses 9 to about 25 or even onward, we see the refrain of this chapter. God's people live faithlessly. They live with distrust and disobedience, and yet God is faithful in his mercy and grace. God's people are disobedient, follow their own ways, and yet God has not left them in his grace and mercy. The people are recollecting and they're remembering the outworking of God's promise keeping. Or what I like to say is God's gracious intervention. God has intervened in every aspect of their life. And we see this all the way through from them starting from verse 9 onward. They look at their history. They look at their story and see how God is the one who's pushed that story forward. And that's the same for us today. As the people look at the Exodus account, the Red Sea parting, as they look at the fact that when they were in the wilderness without food or without water for 40 years, they're reminded of God's great deliverance, protection, and guiding. And yet, the people fail to trust and follow his ways. They're reminded of the promised land that God has given them, and that he continually has given them in their mercy and grace, that they are undeserving of this. And yet, they're faithless, disobedient. God sends to them prophets, a mouthpiece of his word to them, to call them and to turn them back, to look towards their Lord, to see his gracious and merciful, his slow to anger, his patient character, the forgiving God who calls his people to turn back, and yet they would not hear. In fact, they would kill the prophets with closed ears. They would cry out in distress that, Lord, we alone can be saved by you. And so during the period of Judges, God raises up deliverer after deliverer after deliverer. And for a time, there's some rest from their enemies and their oppressors. And yet they continue in the cycle of faithlessness. And when you look at the book of Judges, it's not just a cycle like this. It's a downward spiral that ultimately leads them to forsake the God who has called them. You see, as a people look and remember the history of God's faithfulness, they're seeing their very lives before the faithfulness of God, of how they have not been faithful. How can they stand before this judge of the universe? How can they stand and see that they have not really lived as they ought to before God? Right, they're to be reminded here that when they were following the Lord and when the Lord was guiding them, they lacked nothing. They lacked nothing. And they're seeing, turning away in their unfaithfulness to other things, to even themselves, to trust in themselves, is foolish. And it is foolish. You see, they're realizing here, and it's something for us to know. Sinning against the Lord is more than just breaking God's law. It's more than just an impersonal law that we're breaking. As the law is reflective of who God is and of his very heart, sinning is ultimately estranging the relationship of us and God. You see, as the people see the profound unfaithfulness, what they're seeing here and what they're confessing and they're crying out to the Lord is that they want to see this estranged relationship reconciled, but they cannot do it themselves. And really, the question we have to ask ourselves this morning is, do we have hearts that are softened, that are cut to the core by God's word? Right? Are we humbled in God encountering his people through his word? Right? Does the reality of God's very faithfulness, does it cause us to see the reality of our unfaithfulness to him? How we are actually deserving to be left by God. There's no reason why God should continue in pursuit of his people. There's no reason why God should continue intervening in his mercy and grace. There's nothing in me, and there's nothing in us that the Lord would say that is a good thing in which, because of that, we see the whole appeal is to God's very mercy, his own loving mercy. It's his character. You know, one of my favorite paintings is this right here. If you know who Monet is, that's good. If you don't, you should know who Monet is. Monet is a French impressionist painter, and this is my favorite painting by him. It's just simply called Stack of Wheat. But what's amazing about this painting is that it comes in a series. Right? Monet does an amazing series. You can probably tell that this is Stack of Wheat in the season of winter. The other series are found in different seasons. And there's an autumn one, there's a summer one. It's beautiful in the series. But the reason why this one is my favorite in the season of winter is because it's unlike the others. The way that it's unlike the others is that there's only one stack of wheat. The other ones have more than one stack. But not only that, in the barrenness of this winter, everything else is dead and barren. All the other pictures point to this life that is flourishing. It's only this one alone that has a solemnness to it. But the reason why Monet paints it with stacks of wheat is that he has a very grand purpose in mind in the whole series. The wheat is to signify sustenance and life and survival, perseverance of life. And this is why it's my favorite for me in the season of winter. I don't know why that stack is there. Everything else around it has died or is dying. That stack is preserved even with the snow on top of it. You know, when we think about the very wintry soul of our very life, it's to make us ponder of how we are still here. And when I think about my own life, only reason why I can stand here or even be here is because of God's mercy and grace. The winter doesn't say it all. The winter is desolate and barren. Our wintry souls, our sinfulness, brings us to great despair. But that great despair is so that we may run to the one who provides life and sustenance. Do we have hearts that are cut to the core by God's word? Not only of our sin, but how we have failed to truly trust in Him. His providence, that this story, as they reflect on their story, is meant to be the same for us, that every moment of our story can never be attributed to our glory, can never be attributed to our self-confidence, to our strength. It's because of God's great mercy. Every one of our stories here. It's only by His good providence. And in turn of all of these things, and we have to see the backdrop of our lives, of how we have not responded faithfully to that grace. We have not truly understood the sweetness of God's grace because we have not understood the disparity of our sin, of how we are undeserving of God to continue to hold and preserve us. There's nothing good in me. And we have to come to that reality for all of us that there's nothing good in us. But it's there. It's there alone that we get to taste the sweetness of grace. What is this for us then? We have to turn to His mercy and grace alone. That we see that God, out of His great love, He has heard our cry, our very sorrow. The people here, as they come before this God, they're not trying to justify themselves. They're actually explaining why they should not be justified, why God should have left them. And yet the constant refrain is, God, because of Your mercy, You have not forsaken or left us. God, because of Your mercy, You have not left us. You have not left us to be an end in our sin. That God, that we are not left in our very sorrows of our faithlessness. Right? That they're coming before and they're seeing God as their creator and their maker, their sustainer, their provider, their lover, their deliverer, their redeemer, their very life. And it causes them to turn to Him in their brokenness. If we do not know of our brokenness or the extent of our sinfulness before God, we will not experience and know of His grace and mercy because we will somehow have thought that we have deserved it when we don't. Because the reason why the people are in despair here is the same reason why we ought to. How can our imperfect life, our broken life, stand before the presence and in the presence of the one who is perfect and whole? We've seen verse 31 today, the great truth for us. Nevertheless, in Your great mercy, You did not make an end of them or forsake them, for You are a gracious and merciful God. We see this ultimately for us in Christ. Christ, the one who would come and condescend, right? Christ, the one who would come and stoop low. But not only just come and take on flesh, but the one who would intervene in our very life, the one who would live the perfect life under every trial of every temptation that we were to face, that he would with so put himself under the very sorrow and the miseries of life, of the effects of sin, though he would be sinless. And ultimately, he would be the one who would pour out his grace and mercy on the cross for us. That he would take the price of our very own unfaithfulness and sinfulness. That he would put that upon himself, that we may, in exchange, have the freedom of knowing his grace and mercy to the full extent, a sure hope for us. You know, the people of God, they understand this. We have to understand this as well. As we reflect on the past and the sins, the sin doesn't just evaporate in the air. Our very sin, our very faithlessness, our very distrust, our very doubting hearts, our very stony and cold hearts are placed upon Christ on the cross. That he would pay the price for us. That we may know of his grace and freedom and his mercy. See, we have to see our very brokenness, and this comes as we come before God's word with humbled hearts. And it's there in our brokenness, the deeper and deeper we go into that wintry soul, that barrenness, that we see the abounding, blossoming flower of spring, of the grace that we have in Christ, the mercy that God has shown us. Right, this is a sweeter joy than some temporary joy. God's grace doesn't just meet us in the highlights of our life. God's grace and mercy finds us in the deepest and darkest pit of despair. That we may know the sweetness of it. So, just to close this morning, there is this long quote, and because it's so long, I put it on the screen for us. It's by John Stott, and I'll read this. And this is for us to reflect on as we think about the sweetness of God's grace shown to us on the cross of Christ. That we are so undeserving, and yet the Lord in his love is calling us back to him, to turn to the cross, bring our very brokenness to him, to turn to him and trust in him. It says this: God could quite justly have abandoned us to our fate. He could have left us alone to reap the fruit of our wrongdoing and to perish in our sins. It is what we deserved. But he did not. Because he loved us, he came after us in Christ. He pursued us even to the desolate anguish of the cross, where he bore our sins, our guilt, our judgment, and ultimately our death. And it takes a hard and stony, and I want to add, a cold heart to remain unmoved by love like that. Church, I pray that we would not be unmoved by the love that the Lord has shown us. Grace upon grace upon grace has he shown us. But that grace that he shows us, it calls us to respond here today, not tomorrow, not next week, today. Turn to the Lord. Why? That we may taste of the sweetness of his grace. Run to him in your weakness. Bring your brokenness. The Lord loves when his people run to him in our helpless estate, in our brokenness, and that we will know all the more, be strengthened in our faith, that we can trust in him. And so I pray that our prayer would be something like this: Lord, give us a greater sense of the reality of our sin before you, so that we may have a greater sense of your beauty, of your grace, of your mercy and love to us in Christ. So may we so seek to live a life that is faithful to what he has called us to. He's calling us to respond this day. Turn to the Lord. Turn to Christ. See what God has done. Come with your despair. Come with your hopelessness. Come with the darkness of our sin, but turn to him in faith and see what the Lord has done on that cross. And may we be strengthened for tomorrow and for all eternity to know that we can trust in this Lord who is the promise keeper because he is righteous. And it's according to his mercy that we stand. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you that you are the God who has not left us in our sin, but you're the God who has come and shown us great mercy. Lord, we pray that you would so stir in our hearts to respond in faith to you, to trust in you. So Lord, would you strengthen our faith as we look upon what you have done in Christ. The Lord, that you have taken care of our very sin and the judgment that we have so deserved. Lord, we pray that by your Spirit that we would so be faithful to all your ways, for your glory, for your name's sake. Lord, we thank you. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's all stand. Sing, May the Lord.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord smile on you, shine his light upon you. May the Lord lift you, turn his face towards you, give you his peace, give you his peace.
Blessed
we came to this place today, and blessed now we will go. In the name of the Father, the Spirit, and the Son. Blessed we came to this place today, and blessed now we will go. In the name of the Father, the Spirit, and the Son. So go now in peace. Go now in peace.
Let's close with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.